soul, Lord, just like it is in heaven. Your will be done in our soul, Lord, as it is in heaven. Your will be done in our soul, Lord, as it is in heaven. Your will be done in our soul, Lord, as it is in heaven. Your will be done in our soul, Lord, as it is. Your glory cover the earth as the waters cover the sea.
Calls out. Jesus.
Jesus. The victory's in the name. The miracle's in the name. Jesus. All honor, all power. Oh.
Jesus.
We love you, Jesus.
There's a lot of wonders in the universe and creation, but there's nothing so beautiful as people who know how to worship. There's nothing so beautiful as worship. There's nothing so amazing. I pray that every one of you let the Holy Ghost teach you something that's so beautiful that He can only He can produce on the inside of you. Father, we glorify you. We thank you for the wonderful works of Jesus in our lives. Hallelujah. Thank you for the working of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for the beauty of your eternal life, of your life, Lord Jesus, of your life, Holy Spirit. Thank you for the beauty and the glory of heaven, oh God. Thank you for the beauty and the glory, oh God, of your love. Oh Lord, of your presence. Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, it's good to be here with you in the abiding place. Hallelujah. You can be seated. You know, we're going to, Ann and I are getting ready. Of course, we just got back, but we're getting ready to take off again. And what I want to encourage you to do, we'd like for everyone whose heart's into the kingdom of God and heart's into this ministry to come participate on Friday nights and just for prayer. Pray not only for the things that we're going to be doing in different places of the earth, Norway, two regions of India, Kashmir Valley, then in also in Zambia, Africa. I received word three days ago that the King of the Congo is going to be in the Crusades. What's really cool is that the King of the Congo is baptized in the Holy Ghost. And it's pretty cool because you think about that. Congo was the darkest place. It was known as the darkest place in the earth. And now the King of the Congo is baptized in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Father, we pray in Jesus' name that every person in this place will begin to see themselves the way that you see them. Lord, that they begin to take up the mantle. I'm so blessed with you girls who gather around Ruthanna. Ruthanna's got such an amazing anointing. So blessed with you because you get to inherit it. You serve it. You love it. You admire it. You know, somebody was asking me the other day, they said, and they said, why is it that in third world countries, that there's so many miracles and signs and wonders. And the Lord quickened me why there was so many miracles and signs and wonders, because I was listening to different ministers talk about what they thought, and while they were talking, the Lord quickened me why there's so many signs and wonders and miracles. Because you go into a third world country and they think you're it. You come and you present yourself as someone from heaven, someone with the power of God. And they're very bright people, but they're very childlike. And within that, they're just wide open. In America, in the Western world, everybody's so brilliant. Everybody's so independent. Everybody's in competition. You're trained from a little child to be in competition. You don't really know how to follow leadership. Whereas in Africa, they have a kingdom mentality, because they got a headman, then they got the chief, and then they got the king. And there's a lot of different places like that. Well, really, it's that way pretty much everywhere. It's more of a kingdom mentality. So they have no problem being in submission. It's not taught in the United States of America or in the Western world. Submission isn't taught. It's independence is taught. Each person, doing whatever it is that they think is right in their own eyes. And so, every once in a while you get hold of desperate people who, you also have interest. It's just not desperate, because desperate people can also just be having a whole bunch of hurts and bitterness and stuff going on in their life. They can have, they're violating spiritual laws. If people can learn how not to violate spiritual laws, then they can live free from the law of sin and death. But folks don't know how to not violate spiritual laws. They do it their own thing. They do it their own way. They're playing their own game. But when you get around someone like Ruthie Anna, you're going to inherit what she has. And she's, she inherited through her servitude of the ministry in my life. And, and it was such a blessing to hook up with a lot of different ministries. And, Tim Hall, Evangelist Tim Hall, is going to be here this next weekend. We're going to have at least two nights of meetings. Ann and I may actually have to fly out earlier than what we thought. We were trying to be able to stay till the 12th, but it looks like we might actually have to leave on the 10th. But nonetheless, we're going to at least have two meetings with Tim Hall. And if you can begin to know yourself after the Spirit instead of after who you think you are or who you believe yourself to be or who people have imposed upon you to be, and you start looking at yourself as a new creation, someone who has been begotten of the Father and entrusted with His goodness. Now, Papa's very different than man, and it's very counterintuitive, because greatness with Him is meekness and lowliness. You live in a Western society. You've been taught that the opposite is greatness. You've been fashioned every day of your life to be just absolutely the opposite. And you have to begin to understand then, how do you participate with the Holy Spirit? How do you really begin to obey God? How do you really begin to obey God's word? Because, we can love Him with all of our hearts, but until we begin to obey Him and do what it is He says to do and do it His way and yield to the Holy Ghost, we're never moving forward. We'll never move forward. Because, Father is not interested in us bringing to the table some of our own ideas. Actually, He's not interested in any of our strength and ability at all. He's not even interested in how we put scriptures together. He's interested in how yielded we are to Him. That's it. People come and they imagine these great sermons and they imagine these great ideas. And it's like people just learning how to go out, for example, on the street and minister, or people who are learning how, share their testimony with others. And they come up with all these ideas that they've got to put together some kind of a speech, some kind of a sell, and you don't. You need to learn how to depend upon the Holy Ghost. It's not to say you don't need to read the Word. It means you shouldn't organize something in your thoughts, but you don't have to. You don't have to if you really know how to yield to the Holy Ghost. You don't even need to do that. Then what's going to happen is the Spirit of the Lord will speak through you with excellence and wisdom. And we've got to understand and how to do a better job. I mean, we've just seen so many miracles. We've just seen so many miracles and so many signs and wonders. We were in a church 3 days in Mississippi. That was there 3 days, right? And then we went to Jackson, Georgia. And they just built a great church there. Pastor's been pastoring for 6 years, but They built a church. They got about 700 people normally there. And of course, we were doing a special meeting, so it was more than that. So many people needy, so many people hungry for the things of the Spirit. So many people don't know how to receive. Still, the Lord does works over top of it, does great signs and wonders and miracles. It's amazing things. You know, if we can just hook up with Father, you know, I love what Ruth Anna said. I've been saying it since I saw the text. She said, you know, she goes, I'm not dancing to your tune. I'm not playing patty cake with your demons. I'm not going to babysit your mediocrity. And then I added to it, no lukewarmers. And the Lord told me, he radically gave me this word. He said, get in or get out. He said, tell the people to get in or get out. Because that's really what it means to be hot or cold. Get in, all the way in, or get out. Because lukewarmness, I'll spew you out. It is so, it's so intolerable to me. You know, when you hear Father say that to you personally, you just like, I mean, what happens? You just burn that much more with, well, I'm all in. So what does it look like to be more fully yielded to you? Where can I go find a place of prayer? Because I'm not going to sit here and try to get you to be impressed with me. I'm going to go find a place of prayer. People want to try to talk on behalf of God, learn how to flow in the Holy Ghost, and they've never really learned that beautiful place of prayer. They've never understood that call to a realm. They've only known a discipline. You know, they've known like, well, we got to do this because this is what we're supposed to do as Christians. But what happens when the relationship comes to a place that you feel the pull and you love to go there? And there you begin to be taught by the Holy Ghost. There things begin to, it doesn't matter how tired you are, it's refreshing. I mean, I was praying for people till late last night. Somebody said to me, aren't you worn out? I mean, as many meetings as you've done, my throat's a little worn out, a little bit. I've been screaming, hollering, and singing. But I'm refreshed, man. I'm just so refreshed. I mean, the people, they came and drugged me out of the, they were concerned about me because I had to get up really 3 o'clock this morning, our time. And I did, you know, minister, I preached 2 services this morning, so they came, basically got me out. But there's so many people that want prayer. You know, the laborers are few, and that's really the problem. We've got a human resource limitation here. And I just pray that every one of you will take up the mantle and start doing stuff God's way. I pray that. But you're never going to do that until you find that place that I'm talking about. You'll never do it. Most people are going to, the majority of all the gospels always been preached by the few. The many have stayed at home. And, you know, there's only been a few who've been willing to live the life. There's only been a few that's been willing to stand for the Lord. And then also so many that have gone through at the same time, they've gone doing it their own way based on their own belief system. They really did, it wasn't really birthed in their lives in that place of prayer and relationship with Him. Some people seek God based upon tragedy. You know, there's tragedy going on. There's tension. There's pressure. They begin to seek God because it's not working out. They don't have the money or the finances that they need, or there's devastation in their house, and then they begin to seek God. And then as soon as the trouble clears, they kind of just back off. But how about what happens when you begin to respond to the Holy Ghost and you begin to get so hungry that there's a call to know Him, that you just, there's something going on inside of you towards Him that becomes bigger than everything else in your life. Father wants to develop that in your life. That's available for you tonight. You don't have to wait till sometime in the future, but what's going to happen is you're going to begin to recognize that things have stolen your heart. Things have stolen your affections. And usually it's in the lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, and pride of life, but it doesn't necessarily, it can also be within the realms of hurt, unforgiveness, other areas. I mean, I think what people are most tripped up is the pride of life. I think that there are many good and sincere and honest people, many good people. There are many good Jewish people, very, very, very high morals, high values, and many, many respects have a holiness code that goes beyond the modern day Christian church. They dress very modestly. They would never be caught in, you know, immodest apparel. Same with Muslims. I mean, they're a little bit overboard. They're covering everything. Except for a little, you know, a little place to see out the front. A little dashboard. All right, the list goes on. The Mormons and the Buddhists, and, you know, others. Father wants us to walk in a place of great sacredness, which goes beyond that. So that really does, that sacredness impacts our apparel. We're not going to be flashing around our body and creating lasciviousness, because ultimately I'm either going to be a vessel of glory and honor where Holy Ghost conviction falls on people instead of lust. You think about that. You just think about that. That's going to impact the way we speak, the way that we talk, the way that we dress, because we're sacred. See, if we begin to look at ourselves for the way Father looks at us, we're sacred. And He's got some radical things to say about that. And I, you know, I've watched over and over again where people, you know, I try to interface with people and it becomes simply a wall of concepts. All I can do for you is tell you, you got to find a place of relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ where you're drawn into a realm of prayer and praise. And it shows. It shows that you can, it's seen in every dimension of your life. It's really especially seen in church. People tell me, I hear people, Tim, I've heard this all of my life, but it's, you know, especially as I've gotten older, how much they love the Lord and how much they know the Lord. They don't know how to praise. All they're doing is they're just lying to themselves because they're not, they don't know how to praise. They don't know how to be deeply intimate with God. Now, I do know that there are people who are dysfunctional and they're handicapped because of events in their life and tragedy in their life. But the Lord will heal that. By and large, I'm talking about the general population of people. They don't know how to be deep with the Lord. They don't know how to be deep with the Lord. They don't know how to be emotional with the Lord because that relationship has never drawn them to the depths of their emotions. It's been locked up in concepts. And there's only one way to break that. You have to begin to seek the Lord. He'll be found of you. If you'll draw near to Him, He'll draw near to you. That's for sure. If you come near to Him, He's going to come near to you. You're going to have to say, listen, I want change in my life. I want to know Him. And when you do, when you do, I promise you, you will be found of Him. And everything, you'll discover. He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. And all this stuff that's going down in your life, all this stuff that's happened because you was mistreated in your family, or you were mistreated on the school ground, or you were mistreated in whatever areas that sometimes just captivates people. It takes them their lifetime to get over themselves. Really. Because it's really not the other person that did it to you. It's really you. It's yourself. And so it isn't really taking demon spirits to keep people from the things of the kingdom of God. Just their self, their own baggage. But all of that's only fixed and cured in one place. You gotta learn how to talk to Father. You gotta learn how to have a relationship with Him. You come to a place where you just enjoy being in the love. Prophecy's easy when you're deep with God, when you're emotional with God. It just flows out. Tongues interpretation just flows out. Compassion for the lost is just there because it's deep in your emotions. As long as it's just religious head knowledge, concepts, ideas, you never really have a burden for the lost. You're always intimidated. You never really feel like you're called to prayer. You know, that's somebody else's duty. It's kind of hardship for you. You're always tired. There's always an excuse. There's always a reason. And I pray that you'll allow God the Holy Spirit to draw you into a place for which He has been revealed to, He has come to reveal to every man this grace and this goodness of God in Christ Jesus. And the beauty and the splendor of who He is. You know, Father has given us, it's almost like He's given to us, the power to create our own universe. To say, okay, I want you to design the world that you believe we should all live in. And it's all within the framework of our thoughts and our thinking and our attitudes and our actions. Praise God, He's limited the creative realm. Because that would be hectic if we were living in everybody's created universe. I haven't found a lot of people that I would like to be living their life. I found one, Christ Jesus, and I want to get to know him. And see, the beautiful thing of it is when that worship and that praise is going forth, like I was just hearing Ruth Anna, that's pure worship. You don't hear it a lot of places. It's not reproduced in a lot of people. They can't do that on their own. They got to have somebody else do it for them, then they can follow and blend in. But that's born in a place of relationship. And Father wants that for you. It's not like there's better people than others. There's not. There's not. I was praying for a black man today. I said, do you know that Pentecost was born in the United States of America through a one-eyed black man? Do you realize that there is nobody that somehow is of lesser value to God than others? Don't you realize that Father's got as great a call upon your life and wants to bring it forth as he has had on Abraham or any other great man of God's life? Don't you understand that? Hard for people to get because they've been told all these things all their life. Or, they have had ideas and perspectives of where their real achievement would be, and they got C's on their, report cards, and, they got too many F's, and they just feel like, the self-worth is just nothing. What happens is that you're supposed to have a transition. The worst people are the people who got the A's. They're the worst. Because they become rooted. For the most part, they become rooted. I got A's, but I didn't become rooted. I got B's too, and I got C's as well. But I mean, praise God, I got more A's than I did anything else. But it didn't have as much value. I really probably didn't have as much drive either, because it didn't matter to me. It really did not matter to me. For a period of time, I made it matter because I needed to have a certain GPA to do something. Things so that was all that mattered. I had to do the next thing. It didn't matter to me from a personal self-worth perspective. Man, when all of a sudden we have an exchange of life, when we get to live the life of Jesus Christ, the whole dynamics of your life is supposed to change. The whole dynamics of your life is supposed to change. Everything's supposed to change. Because now you and I get to do something that is a miracle, goes way beyond anything we've ever been, ever able to imagine. Think about it, people. Would you let God the Holy Ghost make real to you what Christ Jesus has done for us? Yes. When he was crucified, when he was buried by baptism into a death, and we were buried by baptism into a death with him, crucified with him, buried by baptism into a death with him. I don't know that we even get that. I don't know that we get that. I think what we first have to get, what we have to try, what we have to be willing to let the Holy Ghost show us, is that Christ Jesus was crucified for us. And I'm not sure that you're going to get that unless you're really talking to Father really earnestly about it. Well, I should back up and say, you're not going to get that unless you're talking to Father real earnestly about it and saying, Holy Spirit, I really want to understand this. I want to move beyond the veil of concepts. And I want to lay hold of the beauty of what you've done for me. I honestly don't need to go do the things that I've been doing. I'm praise God that he's honored me and I'm able to go do the things I'm doing. I'm praise God I'm allowed to go do the things that I'm going to go do. But I don't need that. I need him. I want him. And I'm not going to and if that were ever to distract me from him in any way, first of all, it wouldn't be him. Huh? Second of all, I don't want it. Think about it. The Lord is allowing you, giving you the permission to create your own universe. And too many people allow hate to live in that universe. Too many people allow resentment to live in that universe. They allow ego to live in that universe. They allow unforgiveness to live in that universe. They give permission to themselves to do things that if everybody around them did that same thing that they were doing, it would be complete chaos, a chaotic world. And Father's just seeing, what kind of world would you create? What kind of world do you want? What kind of relationships? If relationships that you have in your life and that your feelings and your attitudes were ultimately cast upon the world around you and all humanity, would you want to live in that world? Are you allowing the love of God to so permeate you and your mercy and your goodness and your grace because you've given yourself over to the mercy and the love and the goodness and the grace of God the Holy Ghost? Which then ultimately, wow, yeah, you'd want everybody to be like that. And God, Father, is saying, look, you're going to create a demonic world and expect to come into my heaven? I've given you the privilege to be a part of my universe and to be a part of my world and to be a part of what I'm doing. And I'm going to show you how to have my love and how to have my mercy and how to have my goodness and how to have my attitudes and how to have my compassions and how to have my consecration to that which is holy and good. I'm going to help you because I know you don't get it. We've only been alive a few years. And we've got a whole lot of things around us that are just the wrong influences and the wrong models. And most people don't know how to say no to someone speaking evil or bad of them. Most people don't even know how to have enough self-control not to retaliate with a wrong spirit when somebody moves into line in the traffic in front of them and queues up against them, kind of thing. We're always, too many people of God allow other people's attitude to create another atmosphere, another environment for them. You're never going to be a part of what God wants to do in the display of His goodness. You can in every way, you know, fantasize and idolize those people like Charles Finney, who would walk into a place and the whole room would come under the conviction of the anointing of the Holy Ghost. But until you quit responding to everybody else's wrong issues and letting that environment now control your thinking and your attitude and your behavior, you're just a prisoner of any demon that's passing by. You're just a prisoner of any unholy thing that sweeps past your head. God, the Holy Ghost, wants to teach us how to let Him rule us, to where all of our responses is in Him. And suddenly, when somebody gives you hate and you give them love, you don't come under the hate, they come under your love. When somebody gives you some wrong attitude, you give them a right attitude. They come under your right attitude, not you coming under their wrong attitude. As soon as somebody is giving you unforgiveness and you give them forgiveness, as soon as somebody is giving you some kind of lust and you give them purity, ooh, I'm telling you right now, because you don't allow it to work in your members. You don't have that going on in your head. You don't have that going on in your closest relationships. People, I'm going to tell you right now, God tells us that we're supposed to imitate Him. And Father sets up people in our lives. Some of us get a chance to have real, true models in our life that we want to imitate. I want to be just like you. I'm going to move like you. When the healings and the miracles were going down, there was a line of preachers and ministers following me around from a success point of view of numbers. They've got so many more numbers. They got huge churches. But they were following me around, watching everything I did because of the healings and the miracles that were taking place. And what were they doing? They wanted to learn how to imitate it. They got some wisdom. Other people just sitting back going, well, I'm not sure that's happening. No, not there. Not there, because the place was arrested with the power of God. And that's what's going to happen when we go overseas. But I'm just giving you an example of what happens. And some of you do that. I've watched some of you. Some of you get in and you imitate. You really imitate. Others of you are just looking on. You're just looking on, and you've got different reactions and different thoughts going on in that. And you're going to have to deal with that, because that really comes down to your relationship with Jesus Christ and nothing else. It comes down to the fact of how influenced you are by a world around you of competition, comparisons, huh? And compromise. And complaint. I got a whole list of C's. The bad C's. Contentions. I won't allow those things to work in my members. Hallelujah. I gave a prophetic word to Pat Schatzline about 2 months ago. And it was a little bit longer that I told him, the Lord says for you to bind yourself to the horns of the altar. He's got this message that he did the other night where he's bound himself to the altar, tied himself to the altar. I mean, I got wrecked. I mean, the anointing of the Holy Ghost has shook the place. Tie me to the altar. And this is what I heard in my spirit. Tie me to the altar, Father, tie me tight. Based upon Isaac's request to his father, Abraham. Because Psalm says, bind the sacrifice to the horns of the altar. God has revealed his light. Huh? His revelation. And so I want you guys to work on that. Just go, I got some more phrases to it, but just think about that. It's got to be born in prayer. See, you can't, if you was to take something like that now, just because it's a good example, I'm bringing out because it's a good example, and you just say, look, this is a Holy Ghost thing. Tie me to the altar, Father, tie me tight. Now, if I went and I just intellectually started coming up with words, it'd be a song. It would just be a song. But if I take that and I get before the Lord, huh? And I don't get before him for a song. I get before him for him. I get before him. I want him. I don't want what's in his pocket. You with me? I want him. I want to live in his universe. I love his world. I love his light. I love his glory. I'm not living in the universe of Satan. I don't like anything about it. I don't like communing with demon powers. I don't want anything about it. I don't know. He himself, personally, is better than love. He himself, personally, is better than life. He himself, personally, is better than the peace. Though I love the love and love, I love the life and I love the peace, he himself, personally, is better than the joy. Though I love the joy, and knowing him personally produces within me this love, this joy, this peace. People, I need to talk to you about how sacred you believe yourself to be. I need to talk to you about the reality that you're going to have to quit knowing yourself after the flesh, and you've got to know yourself after the Spirit, because if you don't, you're never going to know anybody else after the Spirit. You're never going to. If you can't, it's got to start at home. And if you can't see this wonderful grace that God has given, where we've been made a new creation, where we've been begotten of him, where we've been given the splendor and the glory of his own love and life, you're never going to be able to see that on anyone else. And it's all going to be about the stuff. And Papa don't need no more stuff. He's had enough stuff running interference with his life. He's had enough preacher preaching. He's never had enough singer singing. You with me?
Yes.
Your remedy is that you're going to have to go to a place called prayer. Your remedy is you're going to have to go to a place of conversation with him, a place where all of a sudden you say, wait a minute, there's something in the unseen that I want more than what's in the seen. I want my spiritual senses to be more alive and impactive than my natural senses. So then you begin to understand, and so a conclusion begins to be drawn out for you from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, which is radical, and 2 Corinthians chapter 4, to where now you look on those things which are not seen rather than looking on those things which are seen. In other words, your desire is towards the unseen I know it's there. I know you're there. Lord, you purposed, you decided to leave yourself over in the realms of the unseen, to keep yourself in the realms of the unseen. Hallelujah. And I'm going to come hunting you. I'm come looking for you. And you told me how I can get in there. You've given me access by your blood. You told me no sin can come in here. No insincerity could come in here. So I'm going to make sure that I don't have that going on. I'll make sure that I understand that that's part and parcel of what the blood of Jesus Christ will do. And I'm not going to trample his blood. Because if I do, I'm going to outrage God. I'm never going to get in. So there's a lot of things all of a sudden, spiritual laws of life begin to set upon my life. Deep-seated emotional commitments. It's not some kind of head commitment, concept commitment. You with me? This is passion. This is like, I'm not going to violate trust. I look at my son Joshua, my son Daniel, and look at my daughter Elizabeth, and look at my daughter Ruthanna. And I would say, Father, I do not want to do anything that would ever violate their trust towards me. I look at my wife and said, Lord, I would never want to do anything that would cause her in any way to distrust me. I want a relationship that is based upon this love. It becomes a guard for us. It becomes, once again, another layer of accountability, another layer of actual protection, if you would. But bigger than that, it comes to this, it gets now, it's kind of easy when you see somebody, but how about when you don't see them? How does that get developed? God the Holy Ghost comes and jump starts us, man. Huh? He's got the paddles in his hand, you know. He comes and jump starts us. Hallelujah. Whew. Huh? Whew. He comes and produces a river on the inside. Whew. Hallelujah. And that, my goodness, that's unimaginable. Because if I would have gone trying to get a hold of him without this life, without this new heart and this new spirit, without this overwhelming baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire. How far does your cloud of fire reach out, by the way? Does your cloud of fire reach out 1 foot away from you? Is it 6 inches out from you? Is it a centimeter, a millimeter? Does your fire reach out over to the next town? Could you begin to participate with God and let that be enlarged and begin to come into this place and begin to pray and cry out to God? Not legalistically, not because you've got to as a requirement. You got to be seen, otherwise people are going to think less of you. But because you've spent enough time with the Lord that you're moved to compassion, you're a servant of the Most High God, maybe it starts off, you're going to come because someone you want to imitate, a leader that you submitted yourself, has said, come on Friday nights, I want you to begin to pray for the city. I want you to begin to pray for this region. I want you to begin to commune with Father and recognize that there will become prevailing, effective prayers to you. I want you to begin to pray for us when we're in Kashmir Valley. You know, Kashmir Valley has this big sign Satan put up, says, Christians, no trespassing. I'm going to go tear the thing down and burn it in front of everybody. And, you know, it's wonderful when you've got a bunch of people who know how to get into prevailing prayer so that you may open your mouth and speak boldly the gospel as you ought. It's tough, you know. Hey, man, I feel sorry for the people. Well, you know, God's able to make up the difference. They only got one or two people praying for them. What happens when you got a whole church praying? The prayer of faith, not just praying religious prayers. They praying the prayer of faith. You know what the prayer of faith is? You know you're being heard. Ah, that's prayer of faith. Hallelujah. And it's so, you know, that has to be worked out in the closet. Because otherwise prayer can become too much energized by showmanship. Too much energized by competition. Which we have to be on guard for in the Western world because we've been trained how to just do that. We get all motivated because somebody, we don't really like running a race by ourselves. But somebody else gets right up there beside us and boy, we're going to have our best time. Yes. Amen? And it's a full animal instinct. Huh? Are you with me? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. I'm glad. Father wants to take us much higher than we've been living. Yes. And that's what the Word of God is for. The Word of God gives us insight. Father has come by the Holy Ghost to give us wisdom and revelation and knowledge of Him so we can begin to see that there's more with us than are with them. Father will open up our eyes and cause us to have spiritual understanding and spirit knowledge when we cry after it and want it and seek it beyond riches, beyond gold, beyond silver, beyond fame, beyond recognition, beyond approval of men. You know what? The only reason I preach, the only reason I go, is because, Father, I'm under mandate to do it. You know, I got on that airplane, because I got 3 o'clock this morning. I got on that airplane. I fell asleep. I was asleep 4 hours. A flight was 4.5 hours. We're getting ready to go on an airplane. It's going to be 21 hours. And then we got to get on another airplane, go 8 hours. And come back 8 hours. And go over 6 hours. And then get up and go 5 hours, and then come back and go 4 hours, and then go back over 8 hours, and then go from 8 hours to another 8 hours, and be there, and then come back 8 hours, and then come back 21 hours. Huh? What would motivate you to do such a thing? What would motivate you to do such a thing? What would motivate you to do such a thing? I'm gonna agree with the Holy Ghost. Do you know how I get? You know how we get to agree with the Holy Ghost? Start with. I read His Word. And I say, I want that. I want to do that. I love just opening the Bible and just reading. Look down from heaven and behold from thy habitation, your holy habitation, and the place of your glory. Where is your zeal and your strength, the sounding of your bowels, the deep parts of your mercy towards me? I mean, going after God, knowing Him. The first part of it is you've got to know Him, otherwise you're never going to go after Him. You've got to have some kind of an encounter, and Father has given every one of us some degree of an encounter. But what happens if we don't do anything with that encounter? What happens if we put that encounter on hold? What happens if we take it for granted or minimize it or reduce it in value? How is it that all of a sudden we get a revelation that, wait a minute, I've got God's full attention. He loved me so much. He gave His only begotten Son for me. He came to me in a way that goes way beyond anybody else, and he created me anew to where everything about me is totally holy and acceptable about to Him. And then He came and filled me up with all of His glory, and not only did He fill me up with His glory, but so longing to be near to me, He baptized me in His presence. He baptized me in His fire. Am I willing to walk around without experience and feeling the manifest presence of Jesus? Do I need special little factors in my life? I got to have a fat wallet to feel the manifest presence of Jesus. I got to have a big bank account. I've got to have 10 people who approve of me on a daily basis and say that they like me for myself, for to be able to feel the manifest presence. What are the variables that keep you from feeling the manifest presence and moving in the manifest presence? You didn't get your toast right in the morning. If your toast is right, you could go with the manifest presence. Because I'm telling you, it sounds trivial and it sounds kind of somewhat, somewhat sarcastic. But in reality, I'm looking at people who don't know how, many times I'm looking at people who don't know how to walk in the manifest presence of Jesus. And the only thing I know that's can be in running interference is either themselves, their own personal passions and wants, or some demon spirit. And more than likely, it's their own self and personal passions and wants, because by and large, Father, if you want Father, Father's already taken care of the demon opposition. Now, if you could do this, if you're willing to do this, you're going to step into a whole nother realm and dimension with God, and God's going to be able to prepare you to make you useful. And I'm looking for some people. God needs human resources. I'm looking for some people to do it right. I'm looking for some people to do it right. I'm looking for people so totally abandoned to go, because I've got way too many places calling me to come, and I'm only one person, and I can't get there, and I'm not going to wear myself out going beyond the measure of what God has given me. In terms of a human frame and restriction, I can't be awake 24 hours a day. I can't be awake 24 hours a day and be in 10 places at once. So I got to raise people up to go. But I'm not going to send somebody that's anything less than what Ruthie Ann is. Or anything less than where Geneva's functioning. And I could go on and list a few people in here. I wanted to be able to list every one of you in here. Huh? You know, Sandy's going to go and she's going to interpret for me in Cuba. Just as soon as I get back. But one of the things she needs to do, she's doing, I know you took up the mantle, so you're going to begin to pray. You started praying over Cuba. But you got to let your passions go deeper. And you got to be touching them. You got to be touching the fire. The fire's in the house. If you're not touching the fire, if you're somehow isolated from the fire, demonic powers run interference with you. You're isolated from the fire. What fire are you going to get around now? You better go find yourself a place where there's some fire where you'll touch it. You can never touch the fire of God in a place where you don't have great honor and respect for that place, that mantle. You can't. They couldn't even for Jesus. They didn't respect him and honor him and want to be just like him. Forget about it. And they receive nothing from him. The Lord Jesus is always asking people, do you believe that I'm able to do it? William Branham said, all you got to be able to do is convince people that I've sent you and that you have the authority to heal them. And they will, all, every one of them will be healed. Once again, that's why when we go to third world countries, miracles, signs, and wonders are no problem. Because they look at us as the people who got it. And they fall down at our feet and we got to pick them up and say, no, don't fall at my feet. Stand right here. Christ Jesus is going to do the work. Hallelujah. And they usually healed before you get them up. They are usually healed before you ever get to lay hands on them. Praise God. Now, there's exceptions, but you know what? We're going to get to a place. We're going to get to a place real quickly. Get up here, baby. It's right there, darling. We're going to get to a place real quickly where everybody's healed. Why? Because we're going to get up every day and we will contend for the faith that is once delivered unto saints. We will be passionate about signs, wonders, and demonstrations of the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, well, I heard that happen, that happened. Yeah, that was yesterday, man. That don't even matter no more. Besides that, you know, it is not greater works. So I take no solace in that. I'm talking about yesterday. Huh? When I was a younger kid, if you talked about the surf last week, the older kids would thump you upside the back of your head and say, shut up. Right? You grommet. You weren't even hardly doing any catching anyways. So we learned real early on, taught by the ungodly, how not to misbehave. Are you with me? Talk about yesterday. What about now? What you doing right now? What? You talk about a year ago? Give me a break. Where's your passion, in other words? Where's your truth? Where's the reality? Where's the commitment? Where's the consecration? So we get up every day and we're believing God for the greater works. We're contending for signs, wonders, and demonstrations of the Holy Ghost. And we're not, and yes, it's got to be born in prayer. You know, I can hear in people's voice how much they pray. I can hear in people's voice how deeply they pray. How deeply they pray, how emotional they pray. Whether it's just all up here, kind of in their concepts, and that's what I mean up here. Is it in their concepts, or is it in their depths of their being? Is it in faith, or is it in frustration? Is it in love, you know, or is it in doubt? Huh? Is it because of a crisis or because you're needy? And the only way this is ever going to be worked out in your life, the only way this is ever going to become a reality to you, Katie, is that you have to engage. See, you're deciding. Everybody decides who they're going to follow, who they're going to imitate. And Satan sets it up to where the people that you're going to follow is folks that are on TV, Hollywood folks, or people who are, you know, classified by demon spirits, take hold of her. Classified by demon spirits as being cool. Are you with me? Because he creates that persona. You don't know why you're attracted to say this person's cool, everybody likes them, everybody's hanging out with them, you're trying to get an approval of men, and then that ultimately leads people wrong. You have to decide, you're deciding, who are you going to follow? Yeah. I decided a long time ago, when people want me to dedicate their children, I'll dedicate your children, but you're giving them over to the church. Because too many parents have gone home, spoken trash about the leadership, said, I disagree with the leadership. And what they did was they pulled the rug of commitment, yieldedness, and submission out from underneath their kids, and it take them most of their life, if their lifetime, to ever regain their footing with God. Because of unwise parents, they don't even know what they're doing. They got wrong things going on in their thinking, and then they'd allow that to contaminate their kids. You have to shut up. Huh? You really do. We really do. Zechariah wasn't speaking the right thing, and the Lord said, shut up, in a really big way. He just took speech away from him. Said, man, you're going to make a mess out of this miracle, so I'm not letting you talk another day. Your doubt and unbelief, speaking, asking the wrong questions, just quiet till the miracle's done so you don't mess it up. I learned from why Ezekiel, knowing God and knowing the laws of life, said, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth until you speak through me. Because you're going to mess it up. You're going to mess it up. Father's not going to be able to speak through you. I hear people talk about their tongue set on fire of hell. Poor you. I'm going to keep my tongue set on fire of heaven. I'm going to keep my tongue on fire in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on now, listen to me over here. I'm going to serve him. I'm going to be his boy. Hallelujah. I'm going to be yielded to him. I'm going to walk with him. I'm not interested in walking out some thing that was created within the understanding and mind and thinking of a demon who wants to destroy me and everything that God has done. Think about it, people. We're going to have to get some insight and some wisdom. We're going to have to get the knowledge of the Lord. If we'll begin to give ourselves on fundamental decision making to spirit knowledge, that spirit knowledge will increase. Huh? And all of a sudden, you'll be looking out at the water. You'll be looking out at the water, and it'll look like dirt. It'll look like solid ground. Guess what? The Lord's saying, come on. You'll be looking at water. You're looking at water and you need wine, and it looks like it looks pinkish. You know what the Lord's saying? Go ahead and serve it up as wine. And it turns. I mean, this insight of faith, the revelation of faith, spirit knowledge, that all began because I made decisions based upon God's word. I made decisions based upon my affection, my love, my consecration, my commitment, my desire to obey him, my desire to please him, to be a well-pleasing son. This is my beloved son in whom I'm well-pleased. I get to hear Father say that every day to me.
Amen.
Isn't that pretty cool?
Yeah.
You want me to tell you how you can hear Father say that to you every day?
Yes.
Anybody?
Yes.
Would you like that to be able to, that kind of help?
Yes.
Be in Christ Jesus.
Amen. And
when he says it to Jesus, he's saying it to you.
Yes.
Hallelujah. When he's talking to Jesus, he's talking to you because you're in him and he's in you. What a fellowship. What a joy divine. And it's not religious now. It's true. It's living this thing out. It's enjoying the manifest presence of the Lord. It's living under. Hallelujah. It's living under. Imagine that you gave your members, your emotions, your passions, your appetites, your facial features to joy continually, and you wouldn't allow any other influence. You would not allow sadness or sorrow, its demonic power, to work within your emotion. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Because at that moment, you're not living in God's universe now. You're not living in God's world. You're living in another. You're living in a world and a universe designed by demonic powers. You have to decide. It really comes to a place where you've got to draw the bloodline. You've got to draw a bloodline. I'm talking about the blood of Jesus Christ. You've got to draw a bloodline. On one side of it's hell and the other side is heaven. One side of it's disobedience, the other side of it's obedience. One side of it is relationship with demon spirits, the other side is relationship with God. And all that is in the world is on one side of it, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life. And on the other side is the love of God, the love of the Father, those that do the will of God that abide forever. And then you say, I will not cross the bloodline. Because I know how Satan works. He comes and he'll bring temporary insanity. Where you forget every commitment and you forget every vow and you forget every encounter. As it were, for a moment, under that enticement of the demonic. But because you're so consecrated, doesn't matter, you're not moving. You're not going to accept it. You're not stepping over. You won't. Yeah, it's available. It's coming at you right, left, and center. But you've already resigned your will to the Father. It's not available to you. You don't allow it to be available to you. You know, so many people need to understand a move of God. Can somebody help her so I don't have to? People have got to understand a move of God that causes them, as they did in the book of Acts, to take their books of curious arts and magic and sorcery and all the other stuff of idolatry and go burn it and not make it accessible anymore. Mariah Woodworth Edder, those folks, they cried out against what was coming on the media, saying it was right out of hell. Go back and look at it compared to what we have now. It's totally innocent. Where are we at now? Where in our lives are we going to make compromises with the world and still believe that we're going to go on and be developed by the Holy Ghost in the very character, nature, disposition, and splendor of God's universe, the world that He lives in, the place called the Holies of Holies, because His whole universe is Holies of Holies. It's not just one little, area, one little room. It's all His. Heaven and earth is filled with His glory. If you and I give ourselves over to the sacred and understand that to not give ourselves over to the sacred is serious violations. People, let me just read a couple of verses of scripture to you real quickly. Just kind of help you understand this, because it's good. It's good to hold before us the judgments of God. Somebody said, well, you know, a witch doctor over in Tijuana, they put a curse on me. I'll look at him and go, big deal. God put a curse on you. And they look at you strangely. Yeah, because I know, I can see, I got discerning of spirits. You got sin and iniquity going on in your life. The curse of death is there. That curse is that which God said dwells and abides on all sin. The wrath of God abides on all sin. We understand that Jesus did not come to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. Because the world was already condemned. It didn't need to announce that again. It's already condemned because they did not believe on Him. Did they talk you into taking Him out? Huh? Okay. Because, you know, I just don't want anybody to move. I want Allie to be right in the big middle of it, because what's coming down, I want you to be right in the big middle of what I'm saying. I don't want you to edit out these things, because God the Holy Ghost is talking to you. He's given us an anointing on His behalf to perfect you, and without us you can't be perfect. He's given us an anointing to build you up. See, people, I'm going to just say, before I read this verse of Scripture, people don't get this, okay? I want you to get this. Jesus Christ is standing in His church right now, and He doesn't look all sweet and happy, as it were, and just go on whatever you want, bless your heart, like your mama, can I get you something else? He's standing in the midst of the church, and His eyes are flame of fire, and out of His mouth comes a sharp two-edged sword. He says, I know your works, and they not perfect, and you better get it perfect. I'm going to come fight against you. No, that's His church. That's His interaction with the church. That's not later. That's His interaction with His church. Go read it. Go read Jesus' judgments against His immediate judgments against His church. Why? His church is sacred, people. His church is the fullness of him that filleth all things. His church, you try to think that you can touch it and you can possess it and you can say whatever you want about it and you can have your opinions about it. But I'm going to tell you right now, you one messed up person. You have no idea that which you are now trespassing upon. You have no idea the sacred ground that God's allowed your foot to trod. It goes way beyond the mount and the bush that burned with the fire of God. It goes way beyond the tabernacle that was made in the wilderness, a place where Father could dwell in the inner sanctum. It's his church, purchased with his blood, born by the power of the Holy Ghost, baptized in the fire of his glory, the fullness of him, his body, the representation of who he is. People, there's got to be some kind of radical change. I'm telling you, there's got to be some kind of people that will rise up with the seal of the Lord and say, I believe what God has done, and it is holy, holy, holy. It is sacred. It's to be bowed before. He's to be loved and adored. His holy things are to be called honorable. His anointed, those who are full of glory. To not do our own pleasure or do our own will, but to do his pleasure, do his will. Then we'll ride upon our high places in the earth. Then we'll be fed the heritage of Jacob. See, God says, you do this and I'll do that. A lot of people, they don't have the results. And yet they play make-believe with God. In any other place of life, if you did not have the results of those things that you're supposed to get when you do your job, you'd be fired, you'd be re-educated, you'd stop and give up, whatever. At the end of the day, your boss expects results. Sit down here, here's the typewriter, here's paper, type. At the end of the day, if you don't have typed paper, you can't say you sat there and did your work. Oh, I forgot to put the paper in. Oh, sir, you're fired. We don't need you around. Next. But in the community of God's people, we don't have the evidence, we don't have the fruit, we don't have the result. We act like it's God's fault. Somehow we're not anointed, and somehow he didn't give it to us. No, you're not obeying God. You're not doing what he said. He said, you do this and I'll do that. You don't do your own will. Don't do your own pleasure. You call my holy things honorable. Huh? My anointed, you make sure that you treat them properly. Huh? Go read it. I will then result, what will result in? You will walk upon your high places. You'll ride upon your high places in the earth and be fed with the heritage of Jacob. And that's huge. There's a lot of stuff there. That's a big, I mean, that is a, you know, a summary of a lot of things. So with the evidence of the Holy Spirit. Not human love, but divine love. Saturating our being is evidence that we are the sons of God. It's an evidence that we're the sons of God. Yeah, because as many as walk in the Spirit, they're the sons of God. As many are led by the Spirit, they're the sons of God. Well, the evidence of the Holy Ghost is this divine love, same love of Jesus. And he didn't get up one day and just kind of be hateful and just, I'm just grumpy. Nobody really appreciates what I'm doing. He was filled with God's love. It didn't matter what people thought about it. Everybody forsook him. Nobody appreciated what he was doing. Are you listening to me? Give me a break. Father wants to teach us about another love. The love that was revealed to us in Christ Jesus, his only begotten Son, who came and revealed all the Father, who the Father is. Those statements of Jesus revealing who the Father isn't to try to teach us that there's no distinction between the only begotten Son and the Father. It's to help us understand that Christ Jesus is the absolute model and absolute description of who Father is and what Father wants, that he has purposed to reproduce his life, train us up in his life. You are born in sin and every day shaped to be like the devil. Well, you are born in righteousness now to every day now be shaped in the purity of God Almighty. But he's not going to force you. He will not force you. He's not going to force you. Hello. You want to sit there and, you know, boil in your own whatever? Are you listening? Stew in whatever, your own whatever. Marinate. That's what I want to do. Marinate. Marinate me in my problems. Marinate me in my sadness. Well, the redeemed of the Lord have returned and come with singing unto Zion.
Amen. Hallelujah.
And everlasting joy is on their face. So that you can walk around with all your sorrow and sad, tell me the redeemed of the Lord, I'm not buying it. You don't have the evidence, you don't have the fruit. I see sorrow and sadness, you're not the redeemed of the Lord. You walk in a depression, sorry. Now I know that there's some people that need to be healed. I know that there's some physical things, people, tragedy will take hold of people. Great tragedy, a death, loss, you know, loss of loved one, great disappointment, devastation in their life, and they need to be healed, okay? So that's the exception. Are you with me? Are you listening to me? So I'm speaking in general terms, amen? I'm definitely speaking in general terms that apply to everybody, just about everybody in here. Ain't no reason why you're not happy. The Lord doesn't hand out Prozac when you get to the... And come on, people. Oh, I'm going to be different when I get there. No, you're not. Because you're redeemed. The only thing that's going to be different about you, you're going to have a glorified body. How different was Jesus? Now, he did say, Father, glorify me with the glory that I had with you. But from his nature and his characteristic and who he is as a person, is he different Jesus? No. He's got a glorified body. Praise God. The glory that he had with the Father has been restored to him. Hallelujah. But he's not like all of a sudden he gets to heaven, he's got a new nature. He's a brand new person. He's a brand new man. Much of the doctrines progressive sanctification, progressive salvation, all these things of, you know, laying aside the sin and the way, all those are excuses not to be responsible and active right now and have right now what God has commanded. It's always a means of self-justification to put off what God demands today, to put off till later to what God commands today. You know what? I don't care who you are. I don't care how long you've walked with God. I don't care how many things you've done. God requires of you exactly what he said in his word right now. And he's not changing it for you because you're precious and because you're so sweet and pretty. And you're going to be an exception because, oh, you're so sweet. We all need to be understanding of you. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Well, you're going to have to start reading the word differently then. He said, I'm waiting for direction. God said nothing about direction. He said, go.
Amen.
Then when God comes to give you direction, you don't do it. You opted out. Why? Because only one person showed up at my meeting. Oh, so God said, go do a meeting. And if only one person shows up, then stop. That's what he said. Father is faithful. He's going to teach you how to be faithful. And it can't be centered around your little ego. And what you got to have to feel good about yourself. Are you listening to me? One soul is worth what? That's right. He that saves a soul saves the world. Huh? I mean, that's not scripture. That's rabbinic tradition. But nonetheless, it's good rabbinic tradition. One person. We saw, you know, we were so blessed. We saw so many salvations. So many people come to Jesus just over the past 5 days, 6 days. I'm just looking for people in this place that you'll press in and get a special anointing for salvation. Get a special anointing. Because God made an evangel. He's made you a flaming fire. Every single person, he's giving you the fire of an evangel. And if you'll begin to seek him, if you'll begin to talk to him, if you'll get real emotional about him, he'll empower you to talk to people that they can't refuse it. It's wonderful to be talking to people, see the power of God come upon them. See, I read Acts 2:17, he poured out his spirit upon all flesh. I already know what's going to happen. So I'm hooked up with what God said is faith. I don't need to sit there and massage their emotions and massage what they think. Try to make them happy, get them prepared for some tragedy. Human, are you listening to me? It's just nuts. It's so stinking ugly. The way people just bow to the superstition of men to try to present the gospel. Always trying to please men. You ain't going to ever move in an authority until you're ready to get up in somebody's face and tell them like it is. All you are is a grandiose facilitator. You know what I'm saying? You're not a minister of the gospel. But you said in the presence of God, He'll put the fire of His Spirit on the inside of you. And boldness, you begin to speak the word. You speak the word, you watch Him just, you watch the Spirit of God come upon Him. You watch Him break and repent. Power of God just transforms, changes everything. Hallelujah. Your prayers are heard before the Lord. Your tears, you know how important our tears are to Him? I love my wife dearly, but I've never collected any of her tears. Father collects your tears, puts them in a bottle. Every tear that you've shed for your lost loved ones mobilizes heaven. I mean, tell me right now. Listen to me. You listen to me. There are many people who come into the kingdom of God, they never shed a tear for their lost loved ones. They had it was so long ago, my goodness gracious, they can't even remember. We're going to have to go ahead and move on a little closer to Jesus. So we're overwhelmed with His compassions. We're overwhelmed with His intercession. We're overwhelmed with His love. We're overwhelmed with His mercy. We're overwhelmed with His goodness. Come on, people. These things are waiting for you right now, not later. Some people have just basically, they have prolonged so long. They've put it off so long that they don't even know how to respond. God will work a miracle for you tonight so that you can start over, so that you can be converted and become like a little child. True. And it's really responding to the Holy Ghost. Lord, this is what You said. You said, if I do this, I know that I'll have these things. I want you to understand how sacred His church is. I want you to see Jesus standing in the midst of His church. And He's not a little wimpy kind of, you know, somewhat effeminate pastor. He stands with His priestly robes and His kingly garments. His eyes are a flame of fire. He's got a sharp two-edged sword coming out of His mouth, and He's trying the works of that which goes on in the midst of His church. It's a very radical thing. He says, you repent, or I'm going to come fight against you with a sword in my mouth. And He's not talking about the tribulation. He's talking about right now. I'm going to throw her into a bed of affliction, and I'm going to kill her children. Jesus, were you having a bad day preaching that sermon? When you're starting to tell your church, you wretched, miserable, blind. Come on now. It's sacred to Him. Listen, I'll read a couple of verses of Scripture about how He's going to come with flaming fire to execute vengeance upon all those who do not obey the gospel. There is one kind of wrath that God has against the lost. There is another kind of wrath He has against those who violate the sacred. There's another kind of wrath He has against those who are called by His name and violate the sacred. Oh, yeah. You just need to spend more time reading the Bible, and you'll get some holy fear. And you'll quit messing around playing patty cake with demons. Are you listening to me? I love that. I'm not dancing to your tune. Everybody wants us to dance to their tune. Believe it like they believe it. Accommodate them. Not dancing to your tune. Not playing patty cake with your demons. I'm not babysitting your mediocrity. People want us just to leave them alone. Oh, we can't all be like you. We can't all be pastors. We can't all go do these things. I'm not babysitting your mediocrity. I hear Jesus. When Ruth Anna said that to me, it was as a result of you having to deal with some obstinate youth in this church on youth night, I said, that's just nothing but the Word of God. I mean, that almost could make Scripture. People sitting all around like empty shucks. Power of God's all around, and this is how much you know Him. Your spirit's dead to Him. Your spirit's dead. You backslid. Your spirit's dead. When your spirit is alive, the slightest movings of God, there's response. I've looked at many people over the years and they've come into church, and I thought, they go to church anywhere. They go to church, Baptist church, because they don't even know what's going on around them. They go to a Roman Catholic church and be just fine. They won't miss nothing in here because they never touched anything that's going on in here. They're completely isolated. Not because we didn't have the anointing because it was here. Not because we didn't beg. Not because we didn't plead. Not because we didn't challenge. Not because we didn't exhort. Not because we didn't preach the word. But because they did. They were dead by refusal. And then somebody comes along and said, yeah, you know, the pastor, he's really kind of unjust. And now you cast a stumbling block because you imprisoned them that much more against the kingdom of God.
so that they can never respond. And the Lord said, you're not going to be forgiven. That's what he said. Be better that you were not born. Huh? He said, just go commit suicide. No, that's what he said. Go commit suicide. Tie a rope around your neck and throw the block over and drown. That's committing suicide. Then to create the stumbling block, you better watch out what you're telling people about what went down in the meeting. You better watch out what your advice is about what went down through the pastor's mouth. Why people did what? Oh, the babies are crying because he's rough and he's harsh. No, the babies are crying because of the demon that's in your life. The babies are crying because of unrest in your house. You spinning it, right out of hell, violating the sacred. I wouldn't want to be anywhere near you. You better get some holy reverence. You better get some spirit knowledge. You better get yourself isolated over in the things of God so you can begin to understand the terrible violation to be away from Him, to do the opposite. When you over here handling the realms of heaven and in love and relationship with Him and just so wanting to please Him, then these things that I'm talking about will become what they really are, a death penalty. Oh, I tell you, I didn't agree with him on that. You better get yourself mute. Because who are you and what is it that you're doing? It even gives you a right to agree or not agree. All that is a demon power speaking through your mouth, because the Holy Ghost don't talk like that. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm telling you right now, Jesus Christ says you get in. This is a sermon. Get in or get out. But if you're lukewarm, I'll tell you right now, I'll spit you out. I'll say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I did not know you. Because it's really just the same thing that he's saying in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. It's the same thing he's saying there in Revelation chapter 3, verse 17. And here's his patience. Here's his patience. You remember his patience? I'm going to give you a space of time to repent. That's his patience. Patience isn't, oh, let them continue doing what they're doing. They'll come around later on. No, on you. I pray that you understand that if you can't respond to the anointing, you can't respond, you can just be non-responsive to the presence of God. It is a witness that you've not, somehow you've backslidden, you've become entangled with the yoke of bondage. Somehow your spirit's become imprisoned to the influence of the enemy and you can't respond to the Holy Ghost. Because when the Holy Ghost speaks, it's like water. And it's supposed to produce a river. And he's speaking. He's speaking. It's supposed to stir up within your side, in your heart, a commitment. You're supposed to stir up within your heart a consecration. All the more to be those people who live in holiness. Without holiness, you should not see God. God's commanded us to perfect holiness. He's commanded us to give ourselves to he that has his confidence purifies himself even as he is pure. He's commanded us to give ourselves daily, continually, to adding to our faith purity, to walking in his humility. God loves the anointing. It's the sacredest thing that he's got. And if your heart's united with him, you love the anointing too. I just love watching all those ministers just sit there while I'm preaching, just sobbing, weeping. They can respond to the anointing. They've got enough maturity to respond to the anointing. Praise God. They're not just sitting there evaluating. Check. Check. Minus. Check. Minus. Minus. You're getting graded the whole time you're preaching. Agree. Disagree. Agree. Agree. Who cares what you agree with in the realms of knowledge? Come on, what pride of life demon got a hold of you that made you matter so much? You with me? I don't matter. You don't matter. God matters. His word matters. Come on, man. God, the Holy Ghost matters. His will matters. Not my will matters. Father, I mean, if we could just see Father staring at us while we're espousing our opinions and our insights, suddenly we're going to go, ah. Did you overhear that? It's an idiot acting like an expert in the presence of the expert. It's a shame. But it's worse than that. Because it's a stumbling block. Because it's a stumbling block. It's leading people in the wrong direction. It's leading people away from God, away from submission to the church. I pray with all my heart that you'll come to understand that Father is calling you up. He's calling you into a deeper realm of knowing Him, coming to a place of sitting before Him in the realms of the Spirit called prayer. Spiritual realm, coming, sitting before Him in a place of reciting His Word, giving yourself to His Word. First Corinthians chapter 3, I want you to look at this with me quickly. Verse 13. I had some people say to me last night, they said, would you be able to impart the ability to see your behavior always in view of the judgment seat of Christ? Because I had made some mention of that. That when I'm walking around in a consciousness of the Lord, in a consciousness of His presence, in His manifest presence, recognizing that every one of my behaviors and actions are going to be measured and weighed in His presence. I mean, Pat got up in a church last night with probably, I don't know, there may have been, I don't know, there was a lot of people there. Church, I think, holds 1,500. There's a lot of people there. It's mostly full. He said, I saw the handwriting upon the wall. God measured you and you're found wanting. I said, I'm so happy I get to travel around with Him a bit. I love it. You know what I loved more? I didn't see arrogant West Coast, Southern California response. I saw simple Georgians bow and run to the altar. People are different in South. I forgot how different they are. They're more simple. They're bright, but they're more simple. You know, it's just true. I'm not saying that of us. I believe that there is a responsiveness here. I think some of you need to go deeper. You're not going to get broken sitting on your couch. You're not going to get broken. Your will is not going to be bend to Him, continuing on doing the way that you've done things up to this point. Let me help you understand something. If you continue to do things the way you've done them up to this point, you will die being what you are right now. You will not change. You will become more of what you are right now, more solidified, more rooted in who you are, your character, the way you act, the way you function. You've got to have a breaking, bending point to change. Father's made it available, and especially some of you who sit around in a seat of religion or sit around in church for any length of time and not done what God said to do. I don't know that it can be broken anywhere, any other way but by prayer and fasting. I don't think it can be. You don't have to pray and fast. You just have to understand that. To where that you begin to say, bend me, Lord. I want my will bent. I want to be broken before You. I'm going to tell you right now, when you're broken before His presence, listen to me, the sweet oil of the Holy Ghost begins to pour out of you. Understand me. When you begin to understand the relationship opportunity, it's no problem to stand over here on God's side of the bloodline and say, I don't care. I don't care how much it looks good to me, how much it's in my face. Here I stand. I will not bend and I will not bow to it. I have resigned myself not to reach out and touch it. It's unclean and I will not touch it. I'm Yours, Papa. Because see, you do that one or two times, people, and then you understand the great reward of communion. Because I'm telling you, the anointing increases, the manifest presence increases. The things that have not been accessible to you, suddenly they're right there. And you go, hey, I know the reward. I've done this before. I'm going to do this again. Okay, Lord, bring it again. I'm ready. Because He doesn't allow us to be tested above what we're able. Huh? And He holds back a whole lot of things that Satan will throw at us. But now you're ready to get on with the program. I'm ready, Pops. I'm ready. And of course, I'm not dependent upon myself. I'm getting up and saying, Holy Spirit, I want to be so sensitive to you. I'm relying on your protection. I'm relying on your wisdom and your insight. But I'm ready. I want you to enjoy this. It'll change you so radically. It'll change you so radically. It's going to change you so radically. I'm telling you. I can see some of you grabbing hold of it. I can see. I want to see all of you grabbing hold of it. I want all of you to be able to have spirit knowledge, understand what I'm saying. I want every one of you. I don't want anybody to be left out. I don't want anybody to die thinking they're going to heaven and end up in a place called the lake of fire. It's going to last too long. Huh? Listen, I want to reach the lost, but I want to stop the bleed out the back door. I can't believe it that there would be Holy Ghost people that lose their children to the powers of darkness and then not fast and pray about it. I don't even know what that is. You got to quit siding with men's opinions. If you don't know God said it, be quiet. I don't care who you impress with. You just go espousing men's opinion because you like them or you want to just be in their club. You violating things in the spirit. You violating your ability to speak after the heart of God. Just don't have an opinion. Can you do that? Quote the word. Somebody ask you about who's going to be president. Say, I'm looking for a great revival. I'm looking for a great outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Because you don't know what's going on. Are you with me? Unless God gives you revelation. The Lord gave Ruth Anna a vision. She saw in the vision a great cloud of darkness come over the White House. And she saw the Lincoln Memorial split. I know what that means. I praise God that in the church there are people who can see, because the Holy Ghost has come to show us things to come. And there needs to be more people who prophesy, more people who give messages in tongues and interpret also. There need to be more people who worship the Lord deeply and passionately and fall out in his presence, because you're so overwhelmed with your love for Him, and the response of the Holy Ghost in the house just causes that reaction. Come on, people. Let's become emotionally involved with God the Holy Ghost. Let's become intimately involved with the living God. Hallelujah. Woo! I'm emotionally involved with my wife. If I wasn't, it would be terrible. She wouldn't be being loved. She would be a rejected woman. I'm emotionally involved with her. That's how it goes down in relationship. Amen. Praise God. First Corinthians chapter 3. Hallelujah. Katanamaya. Siterimakia tisamaita. Papa's speaking into your spirit. Papa's speaking into your spirit. And you got to command your spirit. And you got to keep yourself with all diligence. One of the beautiful things that God empowers us with is self-control. We call it temperance. Self-control. Hallelujah. And the way God wants us to have self-control is that ultimately that thing, whatever response or reaction that would be anything other than what God the Holy Ghost would do, we stop it, we shut it down, and we deny it. Because we deny ourselves daily. People want to die to people want to die to their self. It's not that easy. You have to deny yourself every day in order to walk in the will of the Father. You can't do your own will. But when you begin to get the benefits and the result of heaven, and this interaction with Him and His empowerment and all the good things that He brings, it's a joy. Man, I'm going to tell you right now, I hate my life in the world because I've discovered my life in Him. The world is crucified to me because I'm crucified with Him, and now I'm freed from it. I mean, so I look over it and there's nothing that is pleasing there. That's supposed to be attractive. I'm not interested in going over and hugging something that's crucified. Oh, I'm really attracted. I just got to have it. You know what I'm saying? Come on, people. Why? Because I'm captivated by heaven. Otherwise, you're just trying to do something out of a legalistic realm. You're trying to buy a piece of land that has a treasure hidden in it, and you've never seen the treasure. You're trying to buy a pearl of great price, and you've never seen the pearl. Papa wants you to see the pearl. He wants you to look at the pearl all day long. He wants you to see the treasure. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 13. Every man's work shall be made manifest. Every man's works shall be made manifest. Every man's works shall be made manifest. For the day shall declare it. I want you to pray with me. I want you to come in this place on Friday night, and I want you to not only pray with what God about and cry out to God about what He's doing in the nations as that we're going to, but I want you to pray and cry out to God for this region, for Southern California. I want you to pray and cry out to God for your lost loved ones. I want you to pray and cry out to God that you'll begin to have the ability to move in your emotions with Him. You know, God first allowed the river, when people get baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, the river's supposed to be coming out of your emotions and passions. That's what Kolia means. So therefore, some of you need to be crying out that you'd be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. You need to be crying out for the Holy Ghost and fire, so that your emotions, your passions will be lit up with God's divine holy emotions. That's compassion. That's deep compassion. Hallelujah. And I want you to be crying out that you would live under such Holy Ghost conviction. You cannot live under Holy Ghost conviction unless you live under the manifest presence of the Lord, which comes by way of agreeing with the Word of God and the Spirit of God. You grieve the Holy Ghost and you're not going to have the manifest presence of God. And if you continue to do things your way, your own way, I'm going to tell you right now, it stinks. And it stinks to God. It grieves Him. For you to continue to walk on in your own way, it grieves God. You're not going to have the manifest presence of God. Start agreeing with the Word of God and agreeing with the Spirit of God. Agreeing with the Spirit of God is as simple as being happy, not sad. Walking in peace, not war. I mean, come on. Walking. Come on now. Walking in love, not hate. He said, I don't really hate. So I'm not really loving either. Well, look, God don't have like. Like don't exist. And at best, it's a mixture, and He refuses a mixture. It's a mixture of love and hate. God doesn't have a mixture. Not if you want it, not if you want what He's purposed for us to have. Begin to cry out to God, there'd be such Holy Ghost conviction in the house. But there can't be Holy Ghost conviction in the house when there's not Holy Ghost conviction in our own individual lives, because we're living stones gathered around the cornerstone to be built up a spiritual house. And if we're not Holy Ghost conviction stones, then we're not going to have a conviction house. It ain't going to happen any other way than you touching heaven, to where your heart touches heaven. Got to be something, it's got to be deeper than the strains of your vocal cords. It's got to be deeper than the strains of your vocal cords. It's got to be down here. The groanings. Papa will produce them for you. Father wants to produce them. Father wants to produce them. Father wants to produce them. I said, Father wants to produce them. And you stand at the crossroads of what's priority to you, what's important to you, because Friday night's when you go out for pizza. Friday night's when you go to bed early. Huh? Friday night's when you watch Barney Miller on TV. Huh? Friday night's when you go to bingo. Or whatever it is. Because that's the way it goes down with people. They deprioritize God. And God said, do something.
Well, it don't fit into me and my plans. I just don't really believe. I just don't. That's legalism. I just don't believe. Really don't believe that's what God has to say anyways.
Well, I just don't really believe you'll make it happen. This is talk your language. I just really don't believe you're right with God. I just really believe that your spirit's dead to God and alive to hell. It's about time you need to be born again. Some people get born again every other day, they backslide. You with me? Huh? We get about 5 minutes of yielding this to the Holy Ghost out of them once a week. Every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by the fire of God. The fire of His presence. By fire. We're talking about the fire of God, the fire of His presence. Same thing as being hot and not cold. Hot's defined by being baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire in Scripture. It's not because you're in an uncomfortable, high-temperatured room. I'm gonna live in the Holy Ghost and fire. I'm living fire right now. I'm living fire tonight. I'm living fire all day. Hallelujah. Bo Rabashe, so are you. So are you. Hallelujah. Pura Satana Meya. If any man's work abide, which he's built upon thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he will suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. Isn't that beautiful? That we could actually go around and build wood, stubble, and hay upon the foundation of God. There is a threshold, believe me. And I begin to speak of the threshold. The threshold can be easily defined by just looking at what Jesus said to the churches in Revelation chapter 2, Revelation chapter 3, and it's more specifically defined. But these are people in honest and sincere commitment, consecration to the Lord, begin to build wood, stubble, and hay. It was things out of the earthly realm. It was things that maybe we can't really even speak in particular about because they've really not been perfectly identified. But we do know they're going to be burned up. And we do know what he's speaking about when he's talking about those things which cannot be burned up. We know he's revealing to us that we're doing His word and doing it His way, and that ought to be really all that is important. We shouldn't be understanding the threshold of what we can get away with. Are you with me? Yeah. We should just be understanding, what is that you want? We're going to do it with that. We're going to go with that. So he says, and then he makes a very, very important transition. He says, because he emphasizes the sacred here, don't you know that you are the temple of God? Don't you understand that you're the temple of God and that the Holy Ghost, God's own Spirit, dwells in you? It's about time the world's able to see that. It's about time people around you are able to see that. It's about time there's enough expression. I'm going to tell you right now, Christ Jesus wants to be manifested through you. Yes, He's manifested. When He's manifested, He destroys the works of the devil. But it's about time that the Lord be manifested through us on a level to where that people begin to see something that's like the lights in the heavens, okay? Because the world can't know us, but they can be captivated by the splendor of our lives. Because we can be like shining lights, because we're supposed to be the light of the world. And they see the joy, and they see the peace, and they see the beauty of His love. Oh, people just, you know, look, I can tell when somebody's got a problem. You can tell when somebody's got a problem with you, right? They just kind of half smile, and you go try to hug them, and it's basically a pass-by hug. You got yourself some problems. You're bound up. You can't tell people they're bound up. I can't even tell people that bound up half the time. Most of the time. 95% of the time. Not until the Lord releases me, because then they basically gonna be that much more bound up. Oh, but it's wonderful when you don't have any carry anything anymore, huh? You can just love, and you don't have to be all awkward moment. Awkward. Feel like you got to give a speech about what happened over the last week in the weather, and it's in the anointing of the Holy Ghost is present. Somebody telling you about the weather and what happened in the weather last week. Weird. We over here in heaven. Let me hear some Spirit of God. Or just don't say nothing. Yeah, you know what? When you learn how to flow in the anointing more and goes deeper in your life and you operate in the anointing, you discover that just talk actually causes the manifest glory of heaven to rescind. It's as though it becomes less. You don't want to talk. You want to stay right where you're at. Man's speech does not impress God. He's like, you guys, I'm going to leave you to talk among yourselves. I'm not going, no, come back. Holy Spirit, hold on, hold on. Please. I'd rather talk with you. I'm going to go with you. Are you with me?
Yes.
So if we're all going with him, we'll just be going as a company, won't we? Huh? Hallelujah. But if you want to go off, talk about the weather and whatever it is that you think so important, you know what? We're just going. Amen? Come on, people. It's time to have Holy Ghost conviction in the house. In other words, it's a sensitivity to the Holy Ghost to do things His way. To know that we are the temple of the Holy Ghost. Can you imagine any way to define yourself more sacred than that? The only way you could define yourself more sacred than that is to say that God Father is in this temple. And He is. God the Father that created the universe is in this temple. Because that's what Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 21. You do what I say. Remember, there's a condition. You do my sayings. You keep my word. My Father will love you, and we will come and make our abode with you. And I will come and manifest myself to you. I want that. We want that. And we want that continually. We want it now. We want it tonight. We want it every day. And we want it to be ever increasing. And so it's our heart longs for this. So therefore, we seek His presence. We seek His presence continually. We understand that there's things that we're going to have to do if we're going to come into His presence. You're not going to come into His presence with sorrow and unthankfulness and murmuring and complaining.
Amen.
He's saying, he already showed us how He's going to respond to that.
Yeah.
Though my work was finished from the foundation of the world, I swear you're not coming into my presence. You're not coming into my rest. Because I'm not listening to your murmuring and complaining. Huh? So we don't violate the spiritual laws of life. We come in with thanksgiving and with praise, hallelujah, and with joy and rejoicing, hallelujah. We stir each other up. If my wife isn't happy for 1 second, I say, what's wrong? Because it's a gigantic transition for her. Some people start smiling and being happy. I think revival has taken place in their life. I was like, yeah, because normal for them is to walk around grumpy and sad and look like God's dead. Are you with me? Let's not do that. Let's be sensitive to the Holy Ghost. Otherwise, you're not going to live in a manifest presence. You're not going to be obeying the spiritual laws of life. And a big part of that is you're going to have to understand that you're sacred. And that this communion that you've been given, this relationship is sacred. And that you don't go violate the sacred things. Because look at what the Lord says. The next verse of Scripture. If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, and you're the temple. If you just took and you cut that out, and you placed it right on your palm of your hand so you could read it all the time so you didn't forget. Hallelujah. Things would begin to change. I promise you. Everybody stand with me, will you? Hallelujah. Rabba baba baba nasha kiteya fahasht. I got a song that I want you and Chrissy to learn. Tonight, I'm asking every one of you in this place to draw a bloodline very clear for you to be able to see it in your life, in your decision making, in your attitudes. You draw a bloodline. And tonight, I'm asking you to consecrate yourself to the behavior of God the Holy Ghost. And I know that some of you have never really learned how to joy, but God will teach you. When you get desperate about learning to joy, instead of feeling like people are picking on you, you know what that is? That is a behavior to preserve the self and defy the will of God. You hear me? I want you to understand, I want to break things down for you people so that you can get it. Because things are not going to move forward in your life and be what God wants to be. God is looking to raise up people that He can use to bring a great outpouring of His presence and power. And He's not going to have false witnesses. You'll listen to me. God is raising up a new breed of people that He can cause to come into all the things that belong to His glory and power that are not going to fall flat on their face and sin and iniquity in the midst of it. God's going to have some real representation of what it means to walk as disciples, those who love one another. He's not going to bring the lost into a place where people are still yapping it out, bad-mouthing one another, complaining and murmuring and looking like they're sad and dejected. It ruined the harvest. He's not bringing His fresh crop into some mildewed, damp silo. Not bringing His fish to dump it upon the shore of human interest and behavior. Tonight, you make a commitment. You bend your will to the behavior of God. You start doing what the Holy Ghost said to do. You start rejoicing evermore. You give yourself to joy unspeakable, full of glory. And if you don't have it, it's cause for you to have a broken heart. If there's anything you should cry about and become broken, is your lack and your displacement from the behavior of God. That should bring you to your knees. People cry because somebody didn't like what they did. Well, God, I'm telling you right now, God, the Holy Ghost doesn't like sorrow and sadness and madness and all these other things that go on in so many people's behavior. It was a reproach against His holy name. And if you give yourself to joy, you're going to have strength in adversity anyway. You give yourself to His divine pleasure, and you're not going to be seeking any other kind of pleasure. You give yourself to His conduct, and you're agreeing with Him that His universe is the one you want to live in. Just imagine that God gave you the power that He has to create a universe and a world that you designed and that you desire. If it don't match His, I'm telling you right now, it ain't going to continue to exist, because the world and the lust thereof is going to pass away. But he that does the will of the Father will abide forever. The will of the Father is not mystical. God's calling you to repentance. God's calling you to consecration. I'm so glad to see some of you, your hands go up instead of in your pockets. So good to see surrender. You know what I'm saying to you? Hallelujah. Hunger. To be disinterested is a terrible thing. It's a terrible crime. Because God's not calling you for your approval. He's calling you for your surrender. God's not talking to you tonight because you're there. He's talking to you tonight because He's calling you there. Time the heart become responsive to the call of God. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. There's a couple of things I want to do real quick before I minister to you more in the altar. And I want to remind everybody about the church building fund for the Amen Training Center. We basically have really about a little over 45 days to get all the finances in on this. And so I know many people have made pledges. I don't want you to wait to the middle of June. I want you to go ahead and just start getting those pledges in. Some of you, I know you made pledges and you're still standing in faith for them. Amen. Well, that's praise God for that. We stand in faith with you for that. But if the if you have the finances, don't delay. Go ahead and bring them in so that we can get things underway. I mean, it's our heart to reproduce the same atmosphere, not anything different. I'm not interested in anything different. I'm not interested in anything different. I don't want anything different. I want something more. I want it more. I want the anointing to be stronger, but I know it's going to go off of this foundation. So we're just pursuing that. We're just pursuing it. I want you to understand that we're pursuing that. Hallelujah. And Father's very happy because I start talking like that and the anointing just goes up. I almost fall out of the anointing. I'm not kidding. I do. I just, power of God just sets down because that's what Papa wants. That's what he wants. He's given me a mandate. He's given me a mantle. And everybody who understands that, joins with it, serves it, support of it, God reproduces it through your life. That's just the way it is. Otherwise, you're on your own. Hope it works out good. It's true. But that ain't the way God is. Father's church is a body. Functions as a body. And he places you where you're supposed to serve. Amen. Everybody say amen. Amen. Father places you where you're supposed to serve and imitate us. Yes. Imitate us. Yes. As we imitate Jesus. Yes. As we imitate God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The anointing is sacred to God, precious to the Lord. Let it be sacred to you and precious to you. Understand it doesn't happen by accident. It happens by active pursuit. Pursuit. Where you learn how to do things God's way, one way, God's way. And then, of course, you know, we want to also invite you to be a part of the things. And you, you know, can do it on whatever level you want to do it on. But, you know, we've got a lot of things going on in the kingdom. And your finances allows you to hook up and participate with what we're doing so that you have fruit to your account. But understand, it's more than just the idea of fruit to your account. It's that you're sowing into the realms of an anointing that God wants to reveal and produce in like manner through your life. And you get to hook up with that. And so maybe I'm running to the nations and I'm preaching on a platform to many, many people. But what happens, and you're hooking up, you are on a platform preaching to 1, 2, 3 people at your business, people on the sidewalk, people in a business place, just living the light, just shining with the brightness, living with the glory. Hallelujah. Press it in, say, Father, give me some insight. Father's going to give you some insight where to go set up the musical instruments and begin to play kind of thing, or where to just, you know, begin to impact people within the circle of your influence. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. So I want you to give. I want you to just give generously. And we're buying most of our airplane tickets tomorrow. And, you know, just believe in the Lord for supernatural provision. It's a little bit nicer to sit in a comfortable seat, but you know what? We're going to do what we got to do. What I want you to do is I want you to labor. I want you to pray. I want you to believe God with us. Amen.
Amen.
And somebody said sacrifice. You know what? Sacrifice for everybody. Beginning with Jesus. I say sacrifice for everybody. Beginning with God the Father. He sacrificed big. Huh? Jesus sacrificed big. Huh? I'm not going on vacation. And if anybody would design a vacation that looks like this, they got some serious mental problems. I'm going to lay down my life. And so I want you to lay down your life too. I'm going to lay down my life. I don't know that Ann and I would return. I trust we will, because I believe we will, because I'm not redundant. There's very few people doing what I'm doing. If there was a bunch of people doing what I'm doing, I'd probably just be redundant. I'd be expendable. But the way it looks like right now, I need to live a couple hundred years. I'm hoping the dynamics of that changes real quickly. And I hope people, a whole bunch of people rise up with an anointing, start moving in the Holy Ghost. You know, it's like one man, and God said, listen, forget about it, man. No, there's very few people who want to be trained in the gift of faith. We don't have time to wait around for anybody else to get trained in the gift of faith, because most of God's people are on such a slow growth program, it would take them 1,000 years to start with. I mean, you know, that's not true, but that's really the way the dynamics appear to be. And so I want you to get into it with me. I want you to develop it with me. And when you sow into what God is doing, He's promised to multiply what you're doing. Not only your finances, He's also tried to, He said He's going to multiply what you're doing, because He says all grace will abound into you. Not just one dimension. He says all grace, so you have all sufficiency in all things. And if you have reduced your relationship to just something that you can monetize, I want to help you. Because all grace to have all sufficiency in all things, I'm talking about miracles, set the captives free, command, you know, the blind to see, the deaf to hear, the crippled to walk. I'm talking about the access into the realms of faith, where we begin to function in a greater insight of visions and dreams and know what's coming, understand what the Holy Ghost is saying, so we, because that's part of the dimension of what the ministry of the Holy Spirit is, to show us things that are going to soon come to pass. And we just going to have to participate with this on every level. I promise you, Ann and I will be emptying our bank account to do this. And we would go into debt if we need to. We're going to do whatever we got to do. And we just want you to join up with us, because this is a price to pay. And we want you to go. I'm going to go prepare a way for you to go. I got one person kind of clapping. You need to go. Amen. That's where the fun is. It really is. It's where the fun is. You're not going to have too many signs and wonders until you start taking a risk. You start risking your life. Somebody said, well, I'm not called to the nations. You know what? You're an idiot. You once again use proof that you're walking in your own will, because God said to everyone, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, uttermost parts of the earth, quit living your own game, man. Now, I just say it in general, because I'm not going to talk to you like that personally. I'm just going to smile at you and look at you. And just say, Lord, I hope they get it. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. We constantly giving way. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to be an idiot. Somebody said, must you speak so harshly? Yes. Hallelujah. Just so that you can get it. Just so that you can remember. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I thank you that every person in this place yields to the gift of faith. They don't hold back. They don't say, wait a minute, I'm going to limit God based upon what I think I can do and what I think I got to have. And I'm going to plan out all my financial needs, and then what's ever left over, we're going to give you some of that, God. But rather, it's turned around and you say, Lord, we're going to give to you, and we're going to know that you're going to take care of us. Hallelujah. I was talking with a pastor today. And he said, you know, when they asked me to take over this church, he said, it was very difficult for me to do it, because the amount of salary that I was going to get, there was no way I could do it. I had to continue to work construction because it was so much less than what I normally make. So I went into the room to tell the other pastors that I couldn't take the church. He said, but I got in there and I just was overwhelmed with peace. And I recognize I've been preaching on faith, and now I'm at the crossroads of whether or not I'm going to move in it. And what God, and he was telling me, he's been doing it, pastoring now for 2 months. And he said, now I'm actually, because of the way that Father set it up and the things, that opportunities that have come in for me to be able to do a little job here and a little job there, I'm actually, I have making more money than I normally was making. And I said, let me just tell you for sure, I know that when you step out and you obey God, he takes better care of you than you ever took care of yourself. Why don't you put him to the test? I know you've been taking good care of yourself, bless your heart. But I'm telling you, Father is going to take better care of you. I promise you. We want to get you into a place. We want you to start participating with faith so you don't have to try to get some at the last minute. Get the faith that's developed. It's developed by persistent participation. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Persistent. Habokaraneya. Horasaradai. To every day get up, believing God for signs and wonders and demonstration of the Holy Ghost, pressing it, not letting up, walking in a sensitivity of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Come worship the Lord with your giving. And also, if anybody, you want prayer for anything, sickness, disease in your body, you got a problem in your body, got a problem in your spirit, we want you to come, we want to pray for you. Perhaps there's someone in this place tonight that you've never been born again. You've never had an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. You're still lost in your sins. You still are a foreigner, an alien for the kingdom of God. Father wants to change all that tonight. You call upon his name, the power of the Holy Ghost to come upon you, change you, make a new creation out of you. Hallelujah. Make everything about you pleasing unto the Father. Hallelujah. So blessed is the name of the Lord. And dear people, I want you to know also, it's just so important to begin to pray for the meetings that we're going to have this weekend. And I'm going to tell you why. Someone's going to come here who carries a special gifting and mantle with mighty deeds and signs and wonders that have been demonstrated in his life. If you don't pray and begin to cry out to God about it all, you're going to take it for granted and you're going to get nothing. You'll get nothing. But you begin to pray for the meetings. You begin to cry out to God for the meetings. You begin to cry out for God to be able to have place to do what it is he wants to do. And out of that, your heart's going to begin to become sensitive to recognize the opportunities, the anointing, and the gifting that's in the house. And who knows, you may be able to grab a hold of it. Amen?
Amen.
And that anointing be transferred into your life and everything be changed. But no anointing of God is so precious and so sacred is ever going to be transferred into your life until it's something so important to you, you've got to have it. As long as it's just common, ordinary, everyday, well, it's just not a preacher is coming. Oh, we'll sit here and listen to him. I wonder how late it's going to run. Oh my goodness, you're gonna do a Monday night service too? You get nothing, man. I tell you right, you're zero. You're getting nothing. Because you're unworthy of it. You're unworthy of it. It's free, but it's not cheap. You gotta want it more. You gotta hunger and thirst out of things of heaven more than anything else. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Just let the Lord talk to you. Just receive that which you have need of right now in Jesus' name.